and somehow it was deemed to be too ignoble for us to engage in the dirty, messy business of planting agents around the world in some of these cells and groups. But why? Because the first thing that they ask of a clandestine agent normally is, prove your bona fides by going out and murdering somebody. Well, that offended our sensibilities. But when you look at what happened yesterday, we have got to get a better human intelligence capability, and we've got to get better security arrangements at our airports, sad to say. You know, we haven't had a plane hijacked in this country in over 10 years, but we had four of them hijacked pretty damn successfully, unfortunately, yesterday. So we need to do some things there. I think we ought to take a look, a reassessment at the executive order that prevents the United States from assassinating terrorist leaders who might be responsible for these kinds of acts. And I can say that because I'm not Secretary of State. Secretary of State says that that reassessment hadn't started, but I bet you at some point it will start. We are engaged in a war.
Mr. Secretary, you've heard, you've gotten a sense from the events of the day and the remarks you may have heard from leaders of Capitol Hill on both sides of the political aisle, getting a sense of the political atmosphere here. What if President Bush were to, for example, issue an order revoking that executive order regarding assassinations? And what if he were to ask the Congress now for a major escalation in military spending? What is your sense of what the response would be at this time?
I think he would get everything he asked for and then some. I think the American people are properly outraged. I think that they are going to demand retribution. I think that they're certainly entitled to it. And I think he would have uniform support across the board.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. It's always good to have you. Thank you for your insights. We're going to have to take a break here, but we'll be right back as Fox News coverage continues.
Attacks which were carried out yesterday against our country were more than acts of terror. They were acts of war.
President Bush's stark words in reaction to the terrorist attacks that have changed our entire sense of security in the United States, beginning with the first attack that began at 8:45 a.m. Eastern Time yesterday in New York City, the first of four hijacked airplanes that slammed into one of the towers of the World Trade Center. And then forever changed everything. We're waiting for some news conferences to happen this hour. We want to go back now to Washington Managing Editor Brit Hume with more information on the news conferences set to come in a matter of moments. Brit?
We do have some briefings upcoming, Linda, but before I get to that, I want to mention something else that is of some consequence here. Incredible sources, according to officials high in the administration, have given us to believe now that in addition to the Pentagon and the World Trade Center, that the White House and Air Force One were also targets of attacks or attempted attacks or planned attacks yesterday. Now, we know this about the White House, that the airplane that struck the White House was seen moments before it headed down the Potomac River and smashed into the Pentagon, flying very near and seemingly on a dead course toward the White House grounds itself. Of course, the president, as we know, was not there at that time. So that may very well be what's referred to by that. In addition, Linda, we've been keeping an eye on events in New England, and Rhode Island police have boarded an Amtrak train traveling through the state near Providence. No indication whether this has any connection to yesterday's attacks, but of course every bit of flurry of police activity is something we watch very closely. Now, we are waiting for the briefing from senior officials of the administration that is about to begin any time now. We're not sure whether we can see a picture from the location of that, but we're waiting and watching for that to begin. There it is. This is the Department of Transportation. And the Secretary of Transportation is expected to be accompanied by that's the FBI headquarters, and we're waiting for a briefing there by the Attorney General and others. The Secretary of Transportation has already issued limited permission for some airports to reopen to allow flights that were redirected, diverted to airports other than their intended destination to begin to fly under very tight and changed security procedures. So, why don't I give it back to you while we await the beginning of this briefing and news conference at FBI headquarters by the Attorney General, among others. Linda?
Okay, Brit Hume, we'll get back to you in just a moment. As soon as those briefings begin, we are also keeping an eye on ground zero, as it were, that area right outside the World Trade Center, where they are still tending to the injured and they are still looking for people trapped inside. Correspondent David Lee Miller has been there since it began. David?
Well, rescue workers have been working throughout the evening. This is a desperate race against the clock to save lives. We do not have an official figure yet how many people might actually be buried under the rubble, but they are desperately trying to get to the survivors. We have some videotape that was shot at the scene just a short time ago, and this is the most revealing look yet at exactly what is taking place at the location where the World Trade Center once stood. It is a grisly and a gruesome process. So far, we are told that 9 people have been found alive at the scene. The most miraculous story, that of a Port Authority policeman named John McLaughlin. He was on the 82nd floor of one of the towers when the building collapsed. He says he rode the debris to the ground, and incredibly, he only suffered 2 broken legs and some broken ankles, but other than that, he is fine. We're also told that 6 New York City firemen have also been found alive at the scene, but as many as 259 uniformed officers are still missing. And by that I mean emergency workers, police and firemen, some of those who first went to the scene moments after the tragedy occurred. Now, as for the area adjacent to the World Trade Center, the federal buildings, it is virtually an armed camp. We see APCs, armored personnel carriers, Humvees, military presence, the National Guard here with automatic weapons patrolling the streets. If you look further west to the West Side Highway, and that's where a lot of the debris fell, that area in Lower Manhattan remains a virtual ghost town. The electricity is still off. We are using battery-powered lights and generators, as are the searchers in their desperate search to find those who still might be alive. Now, getting information is also very difficult because authorities have using all their manpower to try and save lives. There is no command center in place, so we do not have a specific figure as to how many people yet are feared lost, but I can tell you that there are people down here desperately trying to find loved ones. They are filling out forms, being asked to come up with identification marks on their bodies, but so far we can only tell you right now that 9 people have been found alive. Back to you.
David Lee Miller in New York City. David Lee, we'll get back to you in just a moment. Also an update, as Brit Hume was reporting, there is now credible information that appears that this terrorist attack was far more ambitious than even what we saw, that in addition to the World Trade Center in New York City and the Pentagon in Washington, D.C., that apparently the terrorists may have also been targeting Air Force One and the White House. We go now to correspondent Brian Wilson, who is outside the Pentagon right now. Brian?
Yes, incredible information now starting to filter in, and it will bear further investigation. But if those indeed turn out to be true, that's shocking information. Here at the Pentagon, they're still struggling. They have had a difficult time bringing the fire under control. Let's take a look at some of the cleanup efforts that were going on earlier in the day. And you can see they've got a real struggle on their hands here. They had a lot of hot spots, and at one point, some fuel that apparently leaked down into lower levels of the Pentagon at the impact site ignited, causing a fire. And there was, for a moment, we'll show you some pictures of this, another brief evacuation, at least a partial evacuation of the Pentagon. Pentagon employees came out of the building, and just about the time that the evacuation started to hit its stride, they gave the all clear sign and went back in. There is no smoke coming out of the Pentagon at this hour, and they have really struggled, the Arlington County firefighters and the other experts here on the scene, to bring this fire under control. Now, we know that about 80 bodies have been spotted, maybe not recovered, but they know of 80 bodies, 80 deaths in this building. And in a worst-case scenario, since there may have been as many as 850 people working in this particular part of the building, they say the death toll could rise in a worst-case scenario to 800. Other experts say probably won't go quite that high. They really don't have a good sense, though, of how many people were in the building at the time of the attack. We also should tell you that the structure you see behind me, and this is complicating things greatly here at the Pentagon, is very, very unstable. Now, since they now believe that there probably are no other people alive inside this particular area, they say that the chance that someone survived the fire, the smoke, The impact, the collision is very, very slim. They don't want to risk other lives at this time by putting firefighters in a very unstable building. So they are reluctant to go in and try to get some kind of demolition done that makes this whole structure a bit more secure. So here at the Pentagon, we are standing by. We are told that at 3:15, we will hear a briefing from Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld. That's new information, and perhaps we'll get some more information about what they are beginning to learn at the Pentagon about the events of Tuesday. Back to you.
Brian Wilson, also this, two very serious pieces of news coming in, one of them from Chief Political Correspondent Carl Cameron. Lawmakers have been told in classified briefings that additional attacks are, quote, possible, if not probable. They should not assume a false sense of security. They are being told this message has been conveyed with a very deliberate and serious level of magnitude. Now, we do not want to be alarmist here, but we want to let you know what is being told to the leaders on Capitol Hill. Also this, apparently authorities in Providence, Rhode Island, or just outside, have stopped an Amtrak train. AP reporting this, this train having left Boston. Someone on board local stations reporting that that authorities boarded this train just one stop shy of Providence after it left Boston, and that they have taken off at least three people. It is not confirmed that this was connected to the terrorist attacks. It is believed, however, that it may have been. We have with us Boston reporter Bill Rapley. He is in downtown Boston, has more information on the arrest going on there. Bill?
Linda, what has happened here? I'm in Copley Square in the heart of the tourist district in Boston, and on the corner is the Westin Hotel. Now, the Boston Globe website is reporting that three men were arrested at the Westin Hotel late this morning for using a credit card that was associated with the terrorists who took off out of Logan Airport yesterday morning in those 767s that ultimately plowed into the World Trade Center. Now, after the three arrests were made, the Boston Bomb Squad went into the building, and the entire hotel was evacuated. At that point, the crime scene tape went up, and a huge lunchtime crowd was attracted here in Copley Square as we saw the bomb squad go in.
Bill Rapley, we need to interrupt here. We need to take it back to New York City. The mayor is once again giving a briefing about the rescue efforts going on at this hour.
We just finished a one-hour briefing to go over all of the things that we need to get done today, try to get completed before tomorrow. I want to thank Governor Pataki for his strong support and all the assistance the state of New York is giving us. Also, Governor DeFrancesco attended the meeting, and the help of the state of New Jersey has been enormously valuable to us. We have over 2,000 people that we sent to New Jersey who were described as walking wounded, but many of them have ended up in New Jersey hospitals. The New Jersey police, the state police, some of the local police departments in New Jersey, fire departments, are there on the scene helping us and supporting us, and their assistance has been enormously important and very, very valuable. And I thank you very much, Governor. It's really terrific. And that's really been true of everyone. They've all come to our assistance and our aid and our help. And New Yorkers, who are strong and very resilient, and should also know that they have lots of support, lots of people from around the state, from neighboring states like New Jersey, and all over the country that want to help us, want to support us. The president has made certain that the military is deployed in such a way as to keep us as safe as we possibly can be, given the times that we live in. And the New York Police Department and the other agencies are doing everything that they can to assure us as much safety as possible. And people should know that they're not alone, but there are a lot of people suffering with them, there to help them and support them. I apologize to the families of people that are lost right now. We have lots of families seeking information about who was in the World Trade Center. Did they get out? Didn't they get out? Are we able to recover them? Aren't we able to recover them? And we don't know the answers to all of those questions yet. We so far have a body count of 55 people as of about a half hour ago. We were able to take out another person about 3 hours ago, two, three hours ago, a woman who was found still alive, taken to the hospital. So now there are at least four people that we've been able to take out. We're searching for others, and you know, we'll try to get more information, and we'll try to do the best that we can to identify as many people as possible. But I really think this is the situation we're going to be living with for a while, which is we'll only know whether we save someone or recover someone's body when that actually happens. But we'll try to get as much information as possible. We have the airline manifest now. They're being kept by the police department. But if people check with us, the police department and the FBI can check the manifest, and we can get the information for you about whether someone's on the airplane. We would urge people to go back to normal as much as possible, to go to restaurants, go shopping, do things, show that you're not afraid.